Hi, I'm Megan Courtney, Outreach Archivist at the Ruther Library, and I'm here to give you an inside look at these archives, why they're popular with researchers all over the world, and how you can use them here on campus. Let's take a look inside.
Archives have primary sources, which means that they are pieces of evidence of the past. Sometimes this is going to be something like a photograph or a journal. Sometimes it might be meeting minutes. It could be a video. This could be a primary source, depending on how you interpret it. But make sure that you are always interrogating those sources. So think about who, what, where, when, and why these things were made. And in archives, a really important factor is the context. So both understanding the context in which the stuff was created, but also understanding the context of the collection itself. And we'll talk about more of that in a second. At the Ruther, we have three collection areas. So every archive is gonna focus on some different kind of subject area. Here, we focus on Wayne State University, of course, so things like faculty records, student organizations, buildings. We also have records related to the labor movement, so that is kind of a national and international collection. We're probably most well known for those. And we also have urban affairs, which is kind of an umbrella term that's focused more on the Southeast Michigan area, that has to do with politics, activism, community organizations, and all those things. And there's a lot of overlap in those three. Archives try to help you out with understanding context by the way that we arrange the materials. You'll see that this box says Detroit Revolutionary Movements on it. That's the collection that this box comes from. So the collection itself is going to give you some really important information about interpreting archives. Every archival item is arranged into a collection. In this case, the Detroit Revolutionary Movements is an organization. So everything in this collection is either made by Detroit Revolutionary Movements members or was collected in their function. So if they got invited to something, for example, that might be in their collection. Our finding aid will help you understand that more. It's going to show you a historical note, and that'll tell you a little bit of the context that you might need. Some collections are named for people, which means that that person's work and that person's research, whatever they might be doing as a person in the world, that's what's represented in that collection. And each collection has many boxes, many folders. The size varies depending on how much stuff was donated to us. As mentioned, we can have a lot of different formats. Some things can be more visual. Some things might be what we call ephemera, so 3D stuff. We might have things that are print. A lot of the material is print-based. But think about that collection context to help you understand these things. If you see them just sitting here on the table, they only mean what you can observe, which is significant, but it's not everything. In this case, we've got an example here of a photograph. So this particular photograph, when you look at it, just at face value, you can see that it is a woman with gray hair, so she's a little bit older in this photo. The photo itself seems a little bit older. You may not know at first glance what era the photograph is from, but you might be able to kind of deduce. But if all we have to look at is this and we don't know the context, we don't know a whole lot. This is a picture of, you know, a woman of a certain age, the end. But the archives give you some context that's really useful. Even if you're searching online, look for this context, which should be attached to the file or in the display somewhere of the item. In this case, I can turn this over and show you that there is some contextual information on the back. First of all, these are some internal codes, and so if you see these, you might ask an archivist what they mean. You might be able to deduce on your own. But this is some really important information. So UAW Solidarity Photo, Rosa Parks, ND. In this case, okay, we know it's Rosa Parks. That's worth knowing. ND means no date. So if you see that it isn't specifically dated, you might have to deduce that information on your own. And then UAW Solidarity Photo, if you haven't heard of that publication before, you can do a little bit of Googling probably and find out that that means United Auto Workers Solidarity, a magazine that they put out. So now you might have some wonder questions. What is going on with Rosa Parks at this phase in her life that they would have a photo of her? Why does the United Auto Workers want to publish a photo of Rosa Parks? And probably, importantly, what is the story that went along with this photograph? So then you have some sort of clues to follow.
If you need to conduct research in person, you'll do it here in our reading room located on Cass Avenue in the Ruther Library building. We are doing by appointment this term, so please consult with Ruther Reference at wayne.edu and we'll help you understand if we can meet your needs online or if we'll ask you to come in person. While you're in here in the room, the reference archivist will sit in this desk behind me and they'll help you out, so it is a nice opportunity to be able to consult with the archivist as needed. There are a few other things you should know as you get started doing research and as you consider how to understand the context in a box, etc.
When you select materials to look at, you will figure out what box you need. In this case, I'm going to show you some materials in the Focus Hope box. This is box 2. There are many other boxes as well.
So as you consider the context, you might understand, for example, that a lot of this material was created in the 1980s and 1990s, and that will give you some clues about the world that the people who created this material lived in. But you'll also think about the physical context of the material. So in this case, you might be looking at food programs in Detroit, and Focus Hope worked on food programs. In this case, you know, for example, by looking at the finding aid, that you want to know about this folder that has to do with bonus cheese. So you're doing research about government cheese in this case. But there are lots of other folders in here. So it can help you to understand how this organization worked and functioned, to maybe see the speaking engagements for one of the officials, to understand that that is something that was important to this organization, and that is part of the context for this bonus cheese program and the way that Focus Hope participated in that conversation. So in this case, we know, okay, we can pull this out. We will put our out card in here so that we know where we're coming back to. In this case, I have it pre-marked, so good to go. All right, the bonus cheese program. What do we need here? So in this case, we've got a letter that talks about government cheese and how important it actually is to people participating in the food programs to be able to have food that tastes good. So this is from the perspective of a specific person, Eleanor Jositis. If you don't understand her role in the organization, you might wonder about that and figure that out. But you might also skim the other stuff in this folder to understand what else is going on besides Eleanor's letter specifically to John. In this case, you would find a number of different documents in different formats. These help you to understand the context. In most cases, archival collections keep the original order, which means that the stuff in here is actually in the order that Focus Hope left it in. So you might be able to deduce a little bit of clue from that information as well. All the stuff in this folder has to do with cheese, at least according to the way that Focus Hope arranged the material. So keep in mind that it is possible that there are just some flukes of record keeping, and always ask questions of the materials you're looking at. Why is it here? Who made it? And super importantly, how does it interact with all of the other sources of information that are pieces of evidence that I can use in my research? When people are just getting started in their research, sometimes they ask me, how do I know what's important? If I have 50 boxes, I'm just not sure which items in all these folders I need to understand. The reality is you should give yourself some time to look around, to think about what you see, to really absorb that context that we've talked about throughout this video, and also to look at your secondary sources. Consider what other scholars have looked at and try to find those materials and interpret them for yourself. It is great to look at those footnotes and follow that trail. That's a clue that historians use and that other scholars use, but it takes a lot of practice. We're always happy to consult with you. Please ask an archivist. We know what materials people like to use and some of the quirks and the ways that things are arranged, but give yourself some time and understand that research is not necessarily a straight path. Consider lots of different keywords and always keep in mind the context. You might have to search for a different word that people use more commonly in the past, because in archives, we give you all the evidence we can, which means we often don't change the descriptions that donors give us. Again, feel free to reach out whenever you want. Our email here that you can reach us at is Reuther, R-E-U-T-H-E-R, reference at wayne.edu, and we look forward to hearing from you.